I'm standing here tonight as we evaluate the cross of Christ. Brothers and sisters, you need to understand it's not easy to preach on the crucifixion of Jesus. It's never an easy thing to stand before individuals and try to get individuals to understand, as well as the one speaking, how serious it was. You see, the world has the concept of it was just a piece of wood. Oh, they're wrong. Let's just be honest. It was bloody. It was gory. And it is something that one ought not to take lightly. And when one evaluates themselves in light of the cross, and they see that they have not been living up to God's word, they ought to change. We live in a society today, the 21st century that is, that we will make every excuse possible when we are blessed with so much. When Christ hung on the cross for 6 hours, thinking about you and I. Who is Brock? Who am I that the Lord wanted to die for me? Who are you? What have you done that Christ deserved to die? My friends, the crucifixion, or let's just be honest, the execution of our Lord was serious. And we read in the scriptures that it took place at the location known as the place of skull. Now, what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to break it down historically for us to see how serious and painful and cruel crucifixion was. And then we're going to look at Jesus and what it means for us today. The place of skull is what the place was called. We call it Golgotha. That's Aramaic. In Greek, means skull. We sung the song tonight, Calvary. That's the Latin name for Golgotha. Some say it's called the place of skull because maybe there were skulls laid about around the area there, or maybe the place was shaped like a skull. But crucifixion, my friends, was probably, let's just be honest, it was the most horrible form of capital punishment ever devised by man. It appears to have originated with the Persians in 522 BC, but it was practiced from the 6th century BC until the 4th century AD. A man by the name of Constantine I, he banned crucifixion in 337 AD. You see, crucifixion is illegal in the United States of America. But there are some countries who practice crucifixion. You think about the Islamic State of Syria. Those that we know as the ISIS. They crucify people. It's a serious deal. Later, the crucifixion was employed by the Greeks. Alexander the Great, we know of Alexander the Great, we've studied him, most of us have. He crucified 2,000 men of military age. The Jews even used crucifixion on occasion, even though it was originated from the Romans. In the interbiblical age, that is the intertestament period, the 400 years between Malachi and before Jesus in Matthew, Alexander Janius, who lived from 103 B.C. to 76 B.C., he crucified 800 Pharisees who had been in a revolt or involved in a revolt. But as I mentioned before, the Romans were most noted for the practice. In 71 B.C., following a slave revolt in Rome, 6,000 recaptured slaves was crucified. Now let me give you the definition of crucifixion. Are you ready? I know we have evaluated the cross. I know Brother Jimmy Young has preached on the cross many times. But we can talk about it very often to help us. But here's the definition of crucifixion. It's a form of slow and painful execution. Now imagine your Lord, in which the victim is tied or nailed to a large wooden cross, and he's left to hang until he's dead. The prospective crucifixion victim, as rule, was subjected to scourging before the crucifixion. Scourging was a beating with a three-thong whip fashioned of plaited leather studded with bone and metal. The victim was stripped naked and then was secured with leather ties, and he was then beaten from his upper back to the lower extremities of his legs. Brethren, that happened unto Christ before he ever approached the cross of Calvary. Just when we would not think it is enough to hang the man for 6 hours, left to die, they decided to scourge him. Let me give you a description of scourging. The flesh was torn from the muscle. Eventually, the muscle could be shredded from the bone. Now you're seeing bone. The flesh ripped off, the muscle ripped off, and all you see is bone. The bones of the back, that is, including the spinal column, might well have been exposed in this bloody mass. Now, not infrequently, these whippings were scary, fatal, and if you can fathom that in your mind, it should cause you to be scared to death, because that is that which our Lord went through for me and for you. In an article which appeared a few years back in the Journal of the American Medical Association, listen to what a medical doctor, through his studies, evaluated through crucifixion. His name was Dr. W. Edwards. Now let me read this open quote. "The severe scourging, with its intense pain and noticeable blood loss, most probably left Jesus in a pre-shock state." So notice that as he is approaching the cross, he's being scourged. That is where his flesh, his muscles are ripped. You can see his bones. And he's carried to the cross in that condition. Now, moreover, the bloody sweat that was coming down his skin, the doctor said, had rendered his skin particularly tender, that is fragile. It can be easily torn. Now, the physical and mental abuse, the doctor says, meted out by the Jews and the Romans, as well as the lack of food, the lack of water, and the lack of sleep, contributed to his weakened state. Therefore, even before the actual crucifixion, that is, before he hung on the cross, before he was nailed to die, Jesus' physical condition was at least serious, or possibly critical, all before he hung on the cross. Now, do you know of anyone who would do that for you today, even when you do not deserve it? What an amazing Lord we serve. Historically, the shape of the cross is a matter of some controversy. Some scholars believe that the victim was forced to carry only the upper crossbar to the scene of the crucifixion, and the crossbar weighed 125 pounds. No wonder Jesus needed some assistance in carrying that cross. Luke 23, 26, Simon. But at the death site, the upright post might have already been secured in the ground already, awaiting for the attachment of the crossbar. So here you now have a man whose bones are showing, his flesh, his muscles are ripped off. You can imagine the blood. He's walking down that road with a 125-pound cross. Here he is coming to the scene of crucifixion, and now it really just begins. The criminal would be made to lie upon the ground with the crossbeam on his upper back. Can you imagine? And the arms were then attached by the nails. Now, the nails almost certainly were driven through the wrist. The Greek word for the Greek word for hands can also be rendered for arms. It had to be in his arms because the palm tissue cannot carry the entire body. So it had to be driven through the wrist. So now we have a man whose bones are showing. He's bloody. He's suffering. He's hungry. He's thirsty. He hasn't slept. Can you imagine the pain? And now they want to nail him. Wasn't enough. The feet were then nailed also. And in 1968 A.D., it's really not that long ago, the first remains of a crucified man were discovered in Jerusalem. A 7-inch spike was jammed through the young man's heels. The actual cause of death for our Lord was most likely the loss of blood volume and the inability to breathe due to the extension of the body. Jesus most likely was unable to support his body so as to inhale and exhale, eventually suffocate it, and one could usually hang on the cross. Now notice, for 36 hours, sometimes they could survive for days. Brethren, our Lord hung on the cross for only 6 hours before he died. Maybe the beating was worse than the usual. Now, since we have looked at what crucifixion means historically, let us reflect upon some matters relative for us today to the Lord's crucifixion and imagine what has just been said according to history about crucifixion. Would you want to see this live and in color? No. You know, you could get on YouTube. I don't want you to, but you could get on YouTube and you could look at a crucifixion and just imagine that Jesus was probably beaten worse. Do you and I glory in the electric chair? Do you and I glory when someone is being put to death? No, but we can glory in the cross of Christ because He decided to go through that for you and I. I can't emphasize it enough how serious it was. But let's look at this according to prophecy. Just when we get to the point where we are starting to really believe the inspiration of the Bible, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, we know all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. We understand that. But when we look at this in light of prophecy, I almost begin to cry seeing the power that is in words within or contained in a book. How this book does not contradict itself even when it comes to prophecy about the crucifixion of our Lord. Here it is. Turn with me to Psalm 22 and 14. Psalm 22 and 14. As you are turning there, let me mention this to you. And I hope and I pray this very hour that I'm able to deliver this sermon unto you the way it should be delivered. And I know there are others who could do better than I. But I'm trying to get my mind completely and absolutely focused on that day. Brethren, I cannot worry about time. I cannot worry about what's going on after worship tonight. Please understand that when I'm preaching on the crucifixion or when we are examining ourselves in light of the crucifixion, how can we worry about anything else? What are you going through that compares, right? But 1,000 years, here in the book of Psalm, 1,000 years before Jesus' birth. Now notice that. 1,000 years before He's even born, speaking by inspiration on behalf of the coming Messiah, the writer here described the devastation of the crucifixion. Let's read Psalm 22, beginning verse 14. This is prophecy about our Lord. This is I'm going to say this one more time. This is 1,000 years. This is going to have a lot of significance. This is 1,000 years before Jesus was born. In Psalm 22, beginning in verse 14, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierce my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, but they look and stare upon me. They part my garments among me and cast lots upon my vesture. The context, I believe here, is doubtless the most informative, as even there are others, but the most informative portion of the biblical record detailing the physical and emotional trauma through which the Son of God went through the crucifixion ordeal. Moreover, when we think about it in light of how the Bible is right and it's always right, according to prophecy, this right here in the book of Psalm is an amazing declaration in as much, brethren, as it was penned 5 centuries prior to the system of crucifixion itself. Is that not amazing? 5 centuries before man ever devised, before crucifixion was even known to man, it was prophesied. The Bible's right. What an amazing, not only has God revealed Himself to us by the visible things, but when we open this Word, when we study it and meditate on it, not just read it like a story, but we read it as this is life or death. It cuts and pricks at the heart. Now, there they are on the day of Pentecost. They're in Acts chapter 2. And Peter, preaching to them, said, listen, You've killed that. You murdered him. They knew that they did these horrible things. How do you think they feel? Is there any wonder they said, what shall we do? Now, I'm thinking, because I can't think like God, Isaiah 55, 8 and 9, Jeremiah 10, 23, and Proverbs 3, 5, since I can't think like God, I'm thinking if I was God, I would have said, listen, I'm just going to kill you and destroy you. But Peter, by inspiration, spoke truth and gave them another chance. How do you give someone another chance who has done that to you? How do you do it? But they decided to let them repent and to be baptized, that their sins could be washed away, and all of the crucifixion, those that were involved in it, will no more be remembered. That's the God that we serve. I'm happy tonight to know that. And I don't want to preach about any other than He. The prophetic details in connection with the crucifixion, to me, are amazing. They're tremendous. I want you to note for just a moment the following abbreviated list of prophetic details. Now, all of these prophetic details or proclamations were proclaimed years before crucifixion was ever devised. Not just before the first crucifixion, but before it was ever known in the mind of man. It gets better. But in Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 6, Isaiah 50 verse 6, we read that Jesus' back was to be beaten. Now here is something that only happened, according to history, to fools. And His hands, as we read in Psalm 22, 6, 16, His hands and His feet were penetrated. In Psalm 22, 18, we find that His garments would be divided and He would be given vinegar and gall to slack His thirst. Now notice, you don't miss this. You have to, in a sermon, it's hard to grasp this all. If you want this outline, I could give it to you. You go home and read this and review it, and it ought to make you cry. But the vinegar offered to Jesus was cheap Roman vinegar. Wine. And it had a drug mixed into it to dull all the senses. Now, it was custom of the Romans. Now, don't miss this. It was custom of the Romans to offer a man being crucified drugged wine so that he could endure that through which he's going. So think about that for a moment. At least they had some sympathy that they were going to allow the one that is being crucified to have some type of drink that would dull his senses so he can endure this. But Jesus refused it. Would you? Oh, don't dare say you would. We would be begging for it. We would be saying, get me down. I've had enough. Give me that that dulls my senses so I do not feel the pain. But Jesus refused because he had to suffer with a clear mind. Read Hebrews 4:15 with me. It's really heart-wrenching. But in Hebrews chapter 4:15, we know the passage, but you got to know it according to knowing that by prophecy, he was given that drink, but he refused it. One would say, why would he do that if he is the Son of God and can do all things? Well, Hebrews 4:15 has it right. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Amen. It doesn't get better than that. That he denied the drink that would take away the pain because he had to do his Father's will, so the whole world, once he raised from the dead, can know that he's the Messiah. We have no excuse to worship him, to not worship him. On the judgment day, we cannot stand before the Father and say these words, Jesus, you have no idea the things through which I was going. You can't say it. You know why? Because he does know the things through which we go, even more so. Worse. He knows all about it. And that is why he's our perfect advocate. 1 John 2:1, my little children, sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Why does Jesus Christ meet those qualifications? Because he went through these things and did not sin. If you went through these things, having a mortal mind, you would have sinned and probably want it down and not go through the death. That is why you and I can't approach God without that perfect mediator, Jesus Christ. That is why when we take the prayer to the Father, we pray through Jesus because God will listen to him. He's that perfect mediator. What an amazing Lord we serve. And also in John 19:32, it gets even better. Though it was common to break the legs of the victim, you know what I'm about to say, such did not occur in Christ's case. Well, that just mysteriously happened. Was it supposed to be like that? No. He was the antitype of the Passover lamb. Turn with me, if you will, to Exodus chapter 12:46. Don't miss it. Exodus 12:46. Don't miss it. Here in Exodus chapter 12:46, in one house shall it be eaten. Thou shalt not carry forth aught of the flesh abroad out of the house, neither shall ye break a bone thereof. When you start to ask, why did this happen or why did that happen? Christ was to be pointed in every aspect of the old law. He was to be pointed to, that is. Also, a crucified person. Now listen, a crucified person was normally given or was not given a burial. Usually when one was crucified, they were left to rot. They were left to rot and be devoured by animals. Did that happen to Jesus? No. He had a tomb in which to reside or his body to reside. Why? Because divine intervention. It had to happen. If it would not have happened, then I'm closing the book. I'm going to say goodbye. Thank you for the hospitality, and I'm going to leave. But those prophecies came true. Therefore, the Bible's right. Oh, what amazing God we serve. These prophecies are powerful evidence of the divine origin of the Bible. So now, thus far, we have seen what? We have seen, well, we have talked about and seen in our minds, in a spiritual sense, what crucifixion was historically. Just a small thing of what Jesus went through, and then we considered it according to prophecy. How all of those things line up perfectly in order without contradiction according to Jesus fulfilling those things. Now, what does this have to do for you and I? Is this just some sermon that we sit back and say, you know, that's a good sermon? Or is it time to evaluate ourselves and walk out of here and not forget it? But the religious significance is this. During the first century, that is the time Christ was being crucified. Now notice, during the first century, the Jews, and Jesus being a Jew, don't forget that, employed four methods of capital punishment. You know what they were? Stoning, decapitation, strangulation, and burning. That was the four ways of punishment for those that broke the law. But Jesus, being a Jew, was not executed according to those ways. He was executed according to Roman procedure. Now, why would that happen? Well, set aside all the political considerations, and there are reasons for that, brethren. First, Christ had to die in some fashion that involved what? The shedding of blood. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Hebrews 9:22. The four mentioned, decapitation, strangulation, burning, and stoning, would not do. There had to be shedding of blood. And since the wages of sin, that is the payment of sin, is death, Romans 6:23, man by virtue of his transgression forfeited his right to live. Meaning this right here. And I don't know if there are others, if we're being videotaped, I think we are, that can hear this, but the denominational world needs to hear this more than ever, especially those of the Baptist denomination. But those who take away baptism or take it lightly, they need to go to the cross and take away that blood that was shed, because the Bible says that we ought to be washed in it. Let's go back and take away the entire crucifixion of our Lord shedding that blood. He didn't do it just to be doing it, but He did it so you and I could be washed in it, to be clean, cleansed and made new. If baptism is not essential, then why did Jesus shed His blood? I don't understand. Why is there even an argument about being washed in the blood of Christ? Why is that a thing? Why is that being debated upon? If we understand what Jesus went through, and we understand it prophetically and theologically, I'll be glad to be washed in the blood, wouldn't you? However, in the marvelous sacred scheme of things, it was determined that God's Son would offer His life in exchange for man's. Now notice, in as much as the life, if you remember, where did the life reside? In where did the life reside in the Old Testament? Leviticus 17:11. It resides in the blood. It was necessary for the Lord to shed His blood to bring redemption. You are redeemed. I am redeemed, no longer to linger. We sing that song, redeemed. We're redeemed back to God. We're brought back to Him. How? Through His blood. Ephesians 1:7. 1 Peter 3:21, parallel passage with that. Don't forget, Revelation 1:5. I don't even know why I have to sit down with someone who believes in God and talk about baptism being essential. Because Jesus shed his blood so that mankind could be washed in it to have their sins forgiven. I don't even know why it's an argument. It frustrates me sometimes to have to argue about it, but I understand there are those who do not want to do it God's way. Isaiah. In Isaiah 53, 10 and 11, he speaks of the Messiah's soul, his life being poured out unto death. Now, centuries later, the Savior made this statement after Isaiah prophesied about that. In Matthew 26, 28, "For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed," watch this, "for many, for the remission of sins." You see, those animals, they couldn't take away sin. But Jesus was the once for all sacrifice, where instead of sacrificing an animal, we just need to be washed in the blood and our sins be forgiven. Now, what have you done to deserve that? Can anyone here tonight, and that's okay, raise your hand, can anyone give any reason on why you deserve for Christ to have went through this for you? Because I don't know of anything. You don't know of anything. And if you did raise your hand and you were to say something, you would be lying, because it wouldn't be right. Crucifixion had to happen to fulfill the Scripture, and Jesus came to fulfill Scripture. Secondly, or not secondly, if I said that, you would say, well, how many points does he have, right? But let me mention this. Under the Old Testament regime, as mentioned in Deuteronomy 21, 23, hanging a body upon a tree was a special token of accursedness. In Deuteronomy 21, 23, it says this, "He that is hanged is accursed of God." Usually you would stone and then hang the body for public display. Now what does that have to do theologically? Look at Galatians 3, 13. Now notice now that hanging someone on a tree was because he was accursed. Does anyone know of anything that Jesus did to deserve that through which he went? And here in Galatians 3:13, look at it. "Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law," that is the old law, the Mosaic law, "being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree." If Jesus did not hang on the tree, if he died any other way, this passage would be wrong. And guess what? If there's one passage in the Bible that's wrong, then all of it's wrong. But this passage says exactly what it was supposed to say by prophecy and theologically. It is significant that the cross is designated, we understand throughout New Testament, as a tree. Now all who so choose may take advantage of that wonderful gift by being immersed into Jesus' death. We're not partakers of that cross unless immersed. Now, everything falls on the cross. And we're going to just for 5 minutes mention the resurrection. But let me tell you through Scripture how the cross is a witness for you. When you go around and you tell people that you glory in the cross, the religious world in general, those who decide to only go to church on Christmas and Easter and one Sunday a month, they see the cross as a piece of wood, brethren. Don't forget it. One who knows what Christ truly went through could not ever forsake the assembly. Jimmy, I appreciate the good article you put about missing church and forsaking. Some miss because they're physically unable, but some forsake willingly the assembly of the saints. How could they do it? After understanding this, if you believe in the Bible, if you believe in God, and you believe it's inspired of God, and you have been forsaking the assembly, repent. If you don't want to come forward, raise your hand. Someone will come get you and encourage you, but we don't want you to walk out of here lost, because this is serious. How was it that a mode of death so despised as the cross, how can all of this bloodiness, this gory talk, this devastation through which our Lord went, how can it be such a glorious badge of honor for Christians? Because the word of the cross was synonymous and is synonymous with the gospel, 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us who are saved, it is the power of God. I understand now how Paul could write such a statement in Galatians 6:14 where he says, but far be it from me to glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. How could Paul go through physical persecution? How could he be stoned? How could he be in prison? How could he go through the shipwrecks? How could he go through the tumults, the distresses? How could he go through that, brethren? The cross. You see, we quote the passage in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Paul said, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. How can he make a statement like that? He understood the cross. Matter of fact, he was one of them. He was the one killing Christians. How could he say, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain? He meant that wholeheartedly. He would do absolutely anything for his Lord. You put a gun to his head and tell him to denounce Christ, he wouldn't have done it. Why should such a hideous instrument of shame be transformed into an object of glory by the early Christians? As I mentioned before, do men honor today the hangman's nose? Do men honor the electric chair? Do anyone wear these symbols as an item of adornment? Let me tell you why we can glory in the cross. It was because the cross ceased to be an embarrassment. Because on the third day, He rose. You know, if Christ would have just shed all that blood for us and decided to stop there, and He did not have the power to be, if the Father did not have the power to raise Him from the dead, then it would have been embarrassing to see the Lord go through that. Because He was just a man, just like they said He was, but He decided to raise again the third day so that you and I can be raised as well. Had Jesus remained dead, the cross would have been forever an object of infamy, but Jesus arose and so could we. Someone says, what are you talking about? By the invitation, by way of conclusion, look at Colossians 1:12. We know the passage, but I want to look at it and find out how we can be raised with Christ. Maybe you're here and you've never had your sins washed away. Maybe you've never come forward and you've never been immersed in baptism for the remission of your sins. I want to tell you this. That maybe you or anybody that's listening that's not here, if you don't think the water is any significance, it's not. It's the blood of Christ, and it's because God told you to. But in Colossians chapter 2, let me get there, please. Colossians 2, look at verse 12. We're buried, not sprinkled, brethren. There are those who say we need to be sprinkled with Him in baptism. But we're buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen. How can you be risen if you're not buried? How can you be risen if you're sprinkled? But you're buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with Him through the faith of the operation of God. Now someone comes along and say baptism is man's work, and they would be working their way of salvation. But Paul says something different. He says it's the operation of God. He's the one who came up with the system, who has raised Him from the dead. By knowing what I know about the cross now, if I've never had my sins washed away, by knowing what I know about the cross and what it has to do prophetically, theologically, and how it's a witness, if I've never been washed in the blood of Christ, I would have stopped the preacher right now and come forward to be baptized. If I have sinned or forsaken the assembly, if there is one who I have not forgiven, maybe it's a family member, maybe it's a friend who I have not forgiven. I hold hatred in my heart, envy in my heart. and I have not forgiven that individual, I would repent of that right now. I would call that individual and say, I'm sorry. I would make it right. I wouldn't leave here lost. I am compelled to preach the cross, knowing what our Lord went through. I'm ashamed to know that before I was washed in the watery grave of baptism, I was guilty. I'm not guilty anymore. I'm justified. Are you justified? Through hearing, believing, repenting, confessing, and being baptized, you can become a member of the Lord's church. But if you have been baptized, you're a member of the church of Christ, you know you have not been living right. Maybe you play act Christianity Monday through Saturday and you know it. Now is your chance to come forward. I love you. Those of this congregation, the eldership, the deaconship, Brother Jimmy Young, and every other member loves you. We want you to come forward. We're not going to laugh at you. We're not going to make fun of you. We're not going to talk behind your back when you come forward. We're going to meet you with open arms, just like our Lord would. Why don't you come now? Think about your relationship with Christ. Think about how you're living in light of the cross.